Macmillan Audio presents Been So Long, My Life in Music by Jorma Kaukonen. Read for you by the author, with a foreword read by Grace Slick and an afterword read by Jack Casady.
If I think I know someone, I ought to think again. I never knew that Jorma was often walking Winston Churchill's black dog, a kind of depression. What I saw was a bright, funny, superb guitar player who, incidentally, wrote one of my all-time favorite songs, Embryonic Journey. Just today, my daughter, China, and I listened to his song, Genesis, and broke out into a bawling fest. It's such a beautiful piece of work. Having cleared some fog more than 20 years ago, he has opened up and brought out the often poignant feelings of a man looking for a new morning. He's been all over the map, literally and figuratively. He moved on a regular basis among several continents. He has a love of driving almost any vehicle, crossing countries countless times, and just appreciating the people, the scenery, and the sense of freedom. On a constant ride, I'm surprised he didn't just explode at some point. His ability to talk honestly about fear and confusion without sounding maudlin is a finely tuned process. Even if you know nothing of the man, it's a moving story of life pushed to the limits. A good read, a modern parable.
Into the light. What is it that makes us who and what we are? If I truly knew, I wouldn't have to write this book. I've got some suspicions, though. Our first moments of existence grow in the darkness of our mother's wombs. At some point, the moment comes when we venture from darkness into the light of the world. It seems that we've been waiting for a long time. My first memories of light in the world seem to be about 2 or 3 years of age, and I remember this because that light came to me in the form of my mother's song. When Mom is at home doing whatever chores awaited her, she would always sing, and if she wasn't singing, the radio was on and song would fill the room. Music seemed to me to be the reward for being alive. To me, nothing has the power to evoke a place and time like music. It stirs memory in a singular way that is unmatched. Indeed, in my small world back then, light came to me in the form of song. I learned to read in preschool, and some of the first words that called to me from a printed page were song lyrics. As I grew older, it was important that most of my friends liked reading, listening, and singing. As years began to slide into the past, the music that flowed to us from the airwaves began to define a soundtrack in our lives. Coupled with adolescence, this opened a door into a room filled with possibilities and sound. This room was always filled with light, and whatever else might be happening in my life, it was always a summer day there. The light waited for me in the brief moments I played violin in the junior high school orchestra and later when I took piano lessons. It bathed me when I practiced and illuminated me when I played at recitals. Now, I wasn't a prodigy, but I loved performing. People sometimes ask me if I ever had stage fright. I was nervous and excited, but not afraid. For someone who was intrinsically shy as I was, this gave me a way to communicate on a primal level. The first time I played an open mic on a real stage, the light waited for me and invited me in. I walked into that light knowing that it was where I belonged. All my close friends lived in the same world. Jerry Garcia, Janis Joplin, these are names most people recognize these days, but there are many you will never hear about because their light was not quite so public. Awareness of this affinity really hit me 4 or 5 years ago when I was on a tour with David Bromberg. We each took turns opening the show and got together to finish each set. One night, David was playing his part of the show, and I was backstage right, waiting for him to call on me. He was illuminated by spots, and it occurred to me that, as always, I was waiting to be called into the light, and that in one way or another, I have spent my life doing this. The dance with darkness is always with us, but the light is there too. For more better than worse, the music has always been my beacon, and I have followed it most of the time. The sounds of music in general, and the guitar in particular, have always pierced my night with a welcome glow. The feeling of a guitar in my lap and my hand on the neck has always surrounded me in a protective armor of tranquility. After all these years, the feeling is stronger than ever. The light brought me out of darkness and into the world, and at some point I will follow the last light and it will take me home. I'm definitely not in a hurry for that journey. In the meantime, let's get on with the story. Introduction. It's a lovely day here in Southeast Ohio as I begin this journey across the page. I know there's a big difference between blogging and writing a book, and that there are two kinds of people. There are those who talk about writing books and those who actually do it. I guess this is my chance to jump from one camp to another. I need to issue a comprehensive disclaimer here. Sometimes the truth of history is written by those who take the time to write it. Winners and survivors tend to be these writers. I must caution my readers to realize that this history, my history, is drawn from my subjective memory. There will be stories that shape my life as I remember them. As the tell reveals facts that might conflict with my recollections, I will make note of these. All that said, this is my story as I remember it, as seen through the prism of my mind's eye. I can do no better than that. I think about the unseen forces that conspired to cause my forebears to leave the home places where their ancestors had always lived to come to America. Why would you want to leave a place where your family had always lived, where your DNA was imprinted on the trees, on the rocks, in the rivers and fields? Frankly, I don't know. I could not imagine leaving the United States of America, or even the little corner of the universe I have inhabited here in Ohio for more than a quarter of a century. My life has not always been kind or gentle, but most of my crises have been self-inflicted. I have not been singled out because of my religion or lack of it, because of my race or because of my status in society. These days, I'm always trying to make my world a better place, but I want to be able to do it here in my world. As a second-generation American, I know my grandparents on both sides of my family came here to seek a better life for themselves and their children. Did they believe in the American dream? Was there ever such a thing to them, or was finding a home in America just better than hunger, persecution, or death in their respective home places? Sad to say, the old ones who could answer these questions are now all gone. The cards and letters from my grandparents lie in the boxes my parents left me when they passed. They are still wrapped in the ribbon and twine they were wrapped in when my grandparents said goodbye to the old country almost 100 years ago. These little notes stare up at me from their resting places like hieroglyphics. Along with their lives, their joys and dreams, sorrows and longings have been dust for a very long time. Those of the generation before me who could have seen through this glass darkly and brought the pictures into the light are now gone too. Perhaps there is some disaffection in my family with living the way things were. Their diaspora led them across the Atlantic Ocean. Mine led me away from a 9-to-5 bureaucracy and into a world of creative freedom that had very long legs indeed. From rehearsals and jams in small apartments and tiny back rooms to Monterey, Woodstock, Altamont, the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and the world of the Grammys, and beyond, this was the road I lived on. Indeed, this was my embryonic journey and much, much more. 1. Land of Heroes. Jaakko Kaukonen, my grandfather, came over in the days just prior to the 20th century. He came from a little town in Finland near the Bay of Bothnia called Ilistaro. There are still Kaukonens there, and Kaukolas, and all sorts of Kaukas. What possessed him to make such a journey? I never had the opportunity to meet Jack, as he would call himself in America. He passed in Los Angeles in the mid-1950s. He now rests in the Inglewood Cemetery near my grandfather Ida, my uncle Pentti, my dad Jorma, and my mom Beatrice. Tarmo, my other uncle who I never met, is buried in a military cemetery also in L.A. He died while he was still in the service, but we shall get to that. My father told me that Jaakko landed in Ellis Island, and his brother, whose name I do not know, landed in Boston. The two Kaukonen brothers never saw each other again in America, ever. Dad told me they wrote and would occasionally call, but that was it. Finns are a stoic lot. At the dawn of the 20th century, it became profitable to extract copper ore from the deep pit mines of Gogebic County in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. The workers came mainly from Sweden, Germany, England, Italy, Poland, and Finland. The Brits were mostly from Cornwall. My dad and his Finnish buddies affectionately called them Cousin Jacks. The Cousin Jacks brought pasties with them, one of the great culinary inventions of all time. When the men headed down into the pits, their tiffin carriers would be filled with, among other things, pasties. which in addition to being really tasty, stay hot for a long time. There's nothing like a hot lunch when you're a mile beneath the surface of the earth. Ida Palmquist, my grandmother, was from Hanko, Finland, a little seaport town just north of Helsinki. Finland was the eternal battleground between the Swedes and the Russians. Kaukonen is very definitely a Finnish name, whereas Palmquist is from the Swedish heritage, which was present then in Finland and still is. Ida came to Ironwood, Michigan, as did Jaakko. There's work in the mines and languages they all knew. I don't know where she first landed in America. Somewhere, obviously, because there she was. Did she and Jaakko meet immediately? I don't know, and I wouldn't know who to ask. I do know that at some point before she was married, she worked in Montana for a couple years as a domestic. Yep, Grandma Ida was a maid on a ranch. I've got all the postcards she wrote back to her friends in Ironwood when she was working there. Finland to Michigan to Montana and back to Michigan was like crossing galaxies in the early 1900s. She was obviously not afraid to travel great distances to find work and her place in the world. In any case, Ida returned to Gogebic County and she and Jaakko got married. My dad, Jorma Sr., was born on October 24, 1910. His brother, Tarma, was born in 1912, and his brother, Pentti, in 1914. Jaakko realized there had to be a better way to make a living than breaking rocks looking for copper ore in the depths of the earth. He became a tailor. He set up shop on East Aurora Street in Ironwood across from the Carnegie Library. My father learned to speak English at that library. My grandfather Jaakko wound up owning much of that city block across the street. Much more recently, in 1993, as my dad was becoming mobile again after his first stroke, I was blessed to be able to go on a roots trip with him to his old home place. Many of his old friends were still alive then, and to see my father reconnect with them brought the past right up to the present moment. There was Robert Lee, the Norwegian. When he was young, Robert was a ski flyer, a particularly Norwegian version of ski jumping. "Do you want to see the big jump at Copper Mountain?" he asked. "Of course I did." This was a ski flying hill, one of the largest in America. Bob knew a shortcut through the woods. He had a large 4x4 and planned on going off-road. "Do you want me to drive?" I asked the old man. "No, you will go too slow. The Youpers are a tough lot." I also got to meet Frances Ann, who was my dad's girlfriend when he was 13 before the Kaukonens left for L.A. I'm going to pause for a moment here and introduce you to another Jorma oddity. I've been journaling for a number of years, and any time you see passages in italics, they will be from my diary. I'm glad that I kept all this stuff. It's hard to recreate these kind of fresh insights. Saturday, February 19th, 2005, Hillside Farm, Meigs County. I spend lots of time writing about recollections of the past. The journey's not always pleasant, but it is my journey. The road to enlightenment is slow and incomplete at best, but at least I'm making progress. My life today is rich beyond belief. It's not to say that the road is without bumps or that I don't just friggin' lose it sometimes. I do, but not often, not like I used to. Today's a great day. Cleaning the barn, looking at old family memorabilia, throwing much away, saving some. Dad looks at me in a picture from Hancock, Michigan. His face is twisted from his stroke. He is not smiling. The trip to the UP has stirred deep memories in him I can only imagine. Behind that thoughtful look lies a latent twinkle that would say sarcastically, "What's it to you?" As it turns out, Dad, it all meant a lot to me, and still does. There was the old Finn Hall where Dad learned to play the mandolin and the violin. There were the black agate beaches where he played as a kid. There was the old Kaukonen family home on Garfield Street. I wouldn't have missed it for anything. What the hey-ho was going on? Lots, obviously. The Kaukonens were trying to find their way in America, and it took them from Ironwood, Michigan, to Tucson, Arizona. I don't know much about this time except that it didn't work out. They went back to Ironwood again, all five of them, and they remained there until 1923 when they moved to Lincoln Heights in East L.A. The Kaukonen family was on their way to San Francisco, at least at first. In those days, a transcontinental trip was a major undertaking. I have no idea what kind of car they would have owned that could hold five people and all their earthly possessions. In any case, they set out for San Francisco. In an era before interstate highways and paved roads in general, this was a heck of a project. Now, I love to travel, always have. Guess I came by it naturally. When I'm driving somewhere, it's always an existential adventure. Time can stand on its own when you're on the road. I always felt that whether riding a motorcycle or driving a car, you are the captain of your fate, seeking the far places. But automobile travel in the 1920s was way beyond seeking a far place of great adventure. This was a momentous voyage. In that spirit, Yako, the skipper of that little four-wheeled ship, ran into some difficulties. Was it weather by the front range in Colorado? Lack of roads in the Rockies? I do know that they headed southwest and wound up in Lincoln Heights, East LA, instead of San Francisco, and that was that. My dad and his brothers grew up to be Angelinos in what is considered to be the oldest neighborhood in LA outside of downtown. Wow, so here are these Finns. In East LA, Yako started another custom tailoring business. He wound up making clothes for movie stars such as Douglas Fairbanks. The Kaukonens may not have been rich, but they were comfortable and the three kids always had cool clothes. Yako became Jack, Tarmo became Leonard, and Penty became Penn. My dad was still Jorma, but it was important for the boys to be Americans, and if this meant mostly shedding Finnish names, so be it. It wouldn't be until the 1950s that Dad really started to rediscover his Finnish roots. The Great Depression came, and Dad and his two brothers went to Trona, California to mine borax. Ironic. The Finnish family left Ironwood, Michigan, and the mines moved to Southern California, and the kids wound up working in mines. The climate, though, was the antithesis of the Upper Peninsula. Trona in the Mojave Desert is a long way from Gogebic County in Lake Superior. The boys worked for the American Potash Company on scaffolds in the desert in Lake Searles. Mining doesn't seem like a lot of fun, no matter where you find it, but there's nothing wrong with a gig. According to family legend, Dad fell off a scaffold and broke his hip, which ended his borax mining career. My dad went to UCLA, and in 1932, he was an usher at the Summer Olympics. Tarmo and Penty were both talented artists. Tarmo was a figure skater of some accomplishment, and at some point had a hand in training the handling of Leo, the MGM lion. At least that's how family lore has it. On July 14, 1936, Jorma Ludwig Kaukonen met Beatrice Love Levine at a Bastille Day party somewhere in southern Maryland. Dad always loved to play tennis, and I guess he cut a dashing figure that day in his tennis whites with his racket in hand. That's what I heard anyway, and it helped their marriage last more than 60 years. I was born 4 years after they were married, but we'll get to that anon. Beatrice Love Levine's parents were Vera and Ben. My grandmother's family was from the St. Petersburg area in Russia. As I was writing this, I remembered that I knew of some distant relatives in Ellington, Connecticut, where that part of the family took root in America. I went to the internet, of course, to find a cousin named Rose Richling. Sad to say, I found that she passed at 83 on December 6, 2015. I guess we won't be talking for a while. When my mom died on May 8, 1998, there were a flurry of connections with relations who were distant to me, and then they were gone. My life went on, and I lost track. I know there are only so many hours in the day, but this one is on me. So Vera landed at Ellis Island like so many. I don't know when. The name Huskevich was just too much for the immigration officers to deal with, so she became a Joseph. Easier to spell, I would assume. Some of her family became Haskells. Again, easier to spell. What prompted my grandparents to come to this country? I have no idea. When I was younger and could have had this discussion with them, I simply accepted their quaint old world qualities as their norm and focused only on my place in the world. There are stories, though. In the St. Petersburg area, Jews were not allowed to own property in the time of the Tsars. Somehow Vera's father had an arrangement with a wealthy Gentile nobleman, and they owned thousands of acres of timberland of what we now know as Karelia. It seems she lived a life of some privilege. That said, she somehow ran afoul of the authorities and wound up in a gulag. It is said that one of the family's servants took her place and she escaped. Upon returning home, she found that the Cossacks had trampled her brother and killed much of the family. Keep in mind, this is before the Russian Revolution. On her way out of Russia, so the story goes, she dynamited the house of the headman of the shtetl, escaped Russia, and found her way to America. When you're young, it is good to be audacious, she would say with a wry smile. My grandfather, Benjamin S. Levine's family, came from a shtetl on the Dnieper River. His father, Shmuel, was a patriarch of some note and had already brought much of the family over to LA.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.